Running Away, the story of the lost son from Luke 15. Jesus told this story about a boy who ran away. Once upon a time, there was a boy and his dad. Now, one day, the boy gets to thinking, maybe if I didn't have my dad around telling me what is good for me all the time, I'd be happier. He's spoiling my fun, he thinks. Does my dad really love me? The son never thought of that before. But suddenly he doesn't know anymore. So the son goes to the father and says, Dad, I'm better off without you. I can look after myself. Just give me my share of your money. His father is sad, but he won't force his boy to stay. So he gives him what he wants. The son takes the money and goes on a long, long journey to a far-off country. And everything's wonderful and perfect for a while. He can go wherever he wants, do whatever he wants, be whoever he wants. He is the boss. He is free. Sometimes he gets a strange, hungry, homesick feeling inside his heart. But then he just eats more, or drinks more, or buys more clothes, or even goes to more parties until it goes away. But soon his money runs out, and so does his friends. He ends up getting the one and only job he can find, feeding pigs. One day he is so hungry and so desperate, he even tries eating some piggy food. What am I doing? He says suddenly, as if he has awakened from a nightmare. He spits, yuck, ick, all of it out of his mouth. My father is rich. And here I am in a pigsty eating piggy food? He wipes his mouth, dusts himself off. I'm going home. As he starts home, though, he begins to worry. Dad won't love me anymore. I've been too bad. He won't want me for his son anymore. So he practices his I'm sorry speech. All the time, what he doesn't know is that day after day, his dad has been standing on his porch, straining his eyes, looking into the distance, waiting for his son to come home. He longs to hear the sound of his boy's voice. He can't be happy until he gets him back. The son is still a long ways off, but his dad sees him coming. What will the dad do? Fold his arms and frown? Shout? That'll teach you. And just you wait, young man. No, that's not at all how this story goes. The dad leaps off the porch, races down the hill, through the gap in the hedge, and up the road. Before his son can even begin his I'm sorry speech, his dad runs to him, throws his arms around him, and can't stop kissing him. Let's have a party, his dad shouts. My boy's home. He ran away. I lost him. But now I have him back. Jesus told them, God is like the dad who couldn't stop loving the boy. And people are like the son who said, does my dad really want me to be happy? Jesus told people this story to show them what God is like and to show people what they are like, so they could know, however far they ran, however well they hid. However lost they were, it wouldn't matter, because God's children could never run too far or be too lost for God to find them.
Thanks, Andy. She does such an awesome job at that. She does really good. So welcome to Central. It's good to be back. Had 2 weeks away, but I understand Ricky and Jim did excellent jobs the last couple weeks. So thank those guys for giving us time off. So how does God see those who are far away from him? How does he view sinners who make bad choices, who blow up their lives? And how does he view those who may think they're close to him, but really may be further away than those who are making bad life choices? Today we're going to find out as we continue our story in the book of Luke, the prodigal God. Please turn to Luke chapter 15 and let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for just this weekend and the work that you have already done. Father, for 23 young women who have passed from death to life. And we know that there is rejoicing in heaven when each and every one of them came to be your daughters. Father, we thank you for Roger and for an A on a test. And Lord, for the volunteers that worked with him. Father, I thank you for the generous spirit of the folks here who give of themselves to serve your kingdom. And Father, I thank you for the opportunities that you give us to be a part of your rescue missions, rescued sinners, rescuing sinners. And I pray that as we spend time in your word today, as we look at what your heart is for the lost, that Father, we would be compelled to be more like you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Let's take a look at verse 1. Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near him to listen to him. Both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable, saying, "What man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which he has lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost.' I tell you that in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, if she has 10 silver coins and loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin which I had lost.' In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Now, last time we were in the book of Luke, Jesus challenged those who were going to follow him, who were going to call themselves his disciples, that they had to love Jesus above every other person or pursuit in their life, that he had to be number one. He had to be their greatest allegiance. There should be nothing else in their life that takes first place. Only Jesus, that they had to love God more. And that if a person was going to say they're going to follow Jesus, but they don't make him first, then they're like unsalty salt. They're not fulfilling the purpose for which Jesus called them. And now we have Jesus again having a meal. I think Jesus likes to eat. At this meal, we have some tax collectors and sinners. It's a similar meal that we saw earlier in the book of Luke. In Luke chapter 5, there's a guy named Levi. Do y'all remember Levi? Yeah, a tax collector. Levi is a tax collector. And what does Jesus say to Levi? Do y'all remember when he walks by his tax booth? Yeah, right. Follow me. Come follow me and be my disciple. And what is Levi's response? You bet, I'm in. And then what does Levi do after he becomes Jesus' disciple? Has a party, right? He has this huge party, and he tells all his friends, and he tells his neighbors, and he tells his relatives. He says, hey, come to a party at my house. Now, what kind of friends do you think Levi has? Yeah, people just like him. Probably not people that a lot of us would want in their house. And yet Levi invites them all, and on that occasion, too, there were some Pharisees who were hanging out. And how did they respond to Jesus as he's having this, sharing this meal with these tax collectors and sinners? Do you remember? Were they happy? No, they grumbled and they complained. They weren't too happy that Jesus was going to eat with them. And now, here again, Jesus is eating with tax collectors and sinners, and the Pharisees and the scribes are there, and they're grumbling about this. Now, a tax collector during that day was not a profession that you would pick if you wanted to win friends and influence people. It was one of the most despised occupations you could have. You were ranked right up there with the worst criminals of society. I didn't say that. but somebody said that. You were ranked right up there with the worst criminals in society. That you couldn't even give testimony in court because nobody would believe you. And the Jewish tax collector was even worse, because he was seen as a traitor to his own country. And so if you wanted to choose to be a tax collector, you're automatically choosing to be on the outside. And a sinner, you know what a sinner is? Everybody raise your hand. Like, and I found you have to raise it really high, because some of us want to do this. This is what, okay, that's what a sinner is. For the Pharisees, though, what a sinner was anybody who wasn't as dedicated as they were to following the law. It was someone who wasn't as religious as they were. It was someone who wasn't as spiritual as they were. That anybody that was less than a Pharisee in their dedication to following the law of God was a sinner. And so Jesus is having dinner with tax collectors and sinners. And what does it mean when you have dinner with somebody? It means that you're fellowshipping, but you're also accepting them. And now the Pharisees thought that they shared God's attitude towards these folks. They thought that they properly reflected how God saw sinners and tax collectors, that their grumbling represented God's grumbling at them. And so Jesus is going to tell them a series of three stories to show them that their attitude towards sinners is very different than God's. The first story that Jesus tells them is a parable of the lost sheep. Jesus starts off, "What man among you?" Right? And then he says, "You're a shepherd, you have 100 sheep, you lose one. What would you do if you lost one sheep?" Right. Leave the 99, go after the one. What happens when you find the one? Yay, I found it, right? Throw it on your shoulders. You're walking back home. While you're on your way there, you're inviting all your friends. Hey, y'all, come over. We're going to have a big party, right? We're gonna celebrate because I found the sheep that was lost. Now, who's the shepherd in that story? Okay. Who's the sheep? What man among you? Right? Jesus is going to contrast the way the Pharisees see people and the way God sees people. You know what the Pharisees get excited about? Sheep. You know what they get excited about? They get excited about their stuff. And if they lose one of their things, what will they do? They will go to any lengths to find the one thing that they lost. Because why? They really love their stuff. But God, what does he love? Lost people. You guys celebrate when you find a lost sheep. You know what God does? He celebrates. There's a huge party in heaven when one sinner repents. That's what he gets excited about. 23 roses. That's what makes God happy. Now, who are the 99 righteous persons? Well, let's go back to the story of Levi, the tax collector. The Pharisees are grumbling. And remember that Jesus told them, it's not the healthy who need a physician, but it's those who are sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Okay, when he talked about the righteous there, he's using the same word here, the righteous. Now, who are the righteous way back in chapter 5? Not believers. They're the self-righteous. Right? They're the Pharisees. They're the ones who think that they're righteous, that they think that they have right standing with God. So they've rejected Jesus. They want nothing to do with him. They don't need him. They've already earned their own righteousness. So they have no need for Jesus. And there's no celebrating pretend righteousness. The 99 folks who think they're okay and they're already in the kingdom, but don't share the Father's heart, Jesus says it's not them. It's that one sinner who recognized they needed to be saved. That's the one that God rejoices over. And then Jesus tells a second parable. A woman now has 10 coins. She loses one. Each coin would have been worth about a day's wage. So she's not a wealthy woman. She loses one of her coins. What does she do when she loses it? Right. She begins to tear the house apart so she can find the one coin. What happens when she finds it? She tweets out. She Instagram, Facebook. Hey, guess what? I found my lost coin. You guys come over. We're going to have a big party, which probably cost all 9 coins that she had. But she's going to have a big party anyway. What's the point? You care about coins, but what's going on in heaven, right? When one sinner repents, there's a party going on in heaven. You guys care about your stuff. You care about things like sheep and coins. God cares about one lost sinner who repents. You want to know what God thinks about people? God loves people. He will do anything. You will do anything to find your sheep or your coin. God would do anything to find a lost person. That's what God is like. And he tells these two parables, and it's interesting, at the end of both parables, what's going on? There's a big party, right? There's a big party that happens. Do you remember that Jesus said that there was this big banquet that was being held, right? And the people who were originally invited to the banquet, what happened to them? No thanks. I don't think I want to go today. Right? Now you have the Pharisees. What's their attitude towards Jesus? What's their attitude towards the lost? No thank you. Right? They're grumbling and complaining. God's rejoicing. They're grumbling and complaining. They're on the outside, right? In the repentance that Jesus is talking about here, one sinner who repents is this idea of it's a change of mind. It's a new perspective. It's seeing life from God's perspective, the grace that he shows us, his mercy. That it's not a demand on us, but it's a response from us, from a demonstration of God's love for us. Right? And that response is also this gracious gift of a loving heavenly Father. The Pharisees grumble, and God rejoices. So what's your attitude towards the lost who come to faith? Are you rejoicing or are you grumbling? And are you like God in that you will do anything to seek and save the lost? Do you have an impact list where you're going after those who don't know them, doing whatever you have to, sweeping the house or going after the sheep? One thing I forgot to mention, Jesus uses sheep imagery on purpose. Because in Ezekiel chapter 34, God gets on to the shepherds of Israel. The shepherds being the leaders, the ones who are supposed to take care of the sheep. And they're falling down on their job. And so God says this to them. He says, I will be a shepherd to my people. and I will gather them from all the places they've been scattered. I will bind them up. I will carry them on my shoulders. I will bring them back, and I will restore what has been taken from them. And Jesus in John chapter 10 says, I am the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. That he uses that imagery to cause them as a rebuke. They care about their sheep. They should be caring about people. Jesus is going to tell another story. Let's look at verse 11. And he said, a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. So he divided his wealth between them, and not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country, and there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving him anything. But when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I am dying here with hunger? I will get up and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. So he got up and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fattened calf, kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found. And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. And he summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what these things could be. And he said to him, your brother has come back, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, look, for so many years I have been serving you, and I have never neglected a command of yours, and yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you have always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live, and was lost and has been found. The third parable here is typically called the parable of the prodigal son. If you're like me, I wondered what prodigal means, so I looked it up. And it means that you are recklessly or wastefully extravagant. But it can also mean that you're lavishly abundant. So the younger son in this story is definitely wasteful, and he's definitely reckless in his lifestyle. So that would describe the son. But the father in this story is also very lavishly abundant, as we'll see. This story, this parable is, like the Good Samaritan, is one of the most famous parables that Jesus has told. Most folks are very familiar with it. So I trust that you guys are going to be ready for this one, right? Okay, so prodigal son, so what happens here, I just lost my place. See, I shouldn't ask you all those questions when I know the answer. Okay, three characters in this parable. Who's the main character? A man had two sons. The man, right? The father is the character. So we think about the son because we hear a lot about the son, but the father is going to be the character. If you want to know what God's like, read the story. The man had two sons. Now the younger son, for whatever reason, we're not told, he wants out. Right? He wants out. So he comes to his dad and says, give me my share of the inheritance. Now, at what point in your life do you normally get an inheritance? Or in somebody else's life? When they die. So this is not only a very unusual request, but this would be a hurtful request for the father. It's as if the son is saying, I wish you were dead because I want my half of the money. That's what I want, is I want your money. And the first hint that the father is lavishly abundant, you know what he does? He doesn't get angry. He doesn't send his son to his room. He doesn't cut him off and say, okay, that's it. No more for you. What does he do? He actually gives his son his part of the money. And the son then says, I'm out of here. And he goes off to see the world. And he gets to do what he wants to do. And he gets to see what he wants to see and be who he wants to be. Right? That he gets to buy and anything that money can purchase for him, he's spending it on it. You can imagine he has lots of friends at this time. Everybody wants to be a part of his little party, his traveling party that's going around. That he can go to the best restaurants and he can go to the nicest clubs. He can do anything at this point. But then all of a sudden his money starts to run dry. And at the same time, there's a famine in the land. Not a good mix of things. He's out of resources. And so the son, being a bit resourceful, what does he do? He gets a job. Now, this isn't a job that a good Jewish boy would get. Why? Not kosher, right? Feeding pigs. And things get so bad for him, right, that he's not only lost all his money, but he's lost all his friends, right? He had lots of friends when he had money. He has no friends when he has no money. And so he gets to such a place where he's willing to eat piggy food. And then one of those beautiful phrases in the Bible. But God is one of them. Here's another one. He came to his senses. And what does that mean? That is a perfect description of repentance. Right? He came to his senses. He recognized he needed help. Right? The narrow door is not far. The kingdom is right on the other side. He recognizes that he needs help. He comes to his senses. He says, oh, my father. Right? What did Jesus say about those who humble themselves? They will be exalted. Right? That he's humbling himself. He says, I'll go to my father and I'll beg him. I'll say I'm sorry. And he humbles himself and he's right there knocking on the door. And so the son comes back and he's expecting, he's worked on his little speech and he's expecting that his father is going to be quite angry with him, right? He doesn't know. He's blown a lot of money. Second example of the lavishness of the father. What is the father doing? He's doing what? He's watching for the son. And when he sees the son, what does he do? He runs to him. He is very undignified. Right? He tucks his robe into his pants and he runs as fast as he can. And he embraces his son. Right? Says he felt compassion. He embraces his son. And he kisses him. Now, did the son, you think, did he stop by Holiday Inn and take a shower? No, he's still got piggy stuff on him. And yet the father embraces him, and he can't stop kissing him. Right? And he says, get the best robe. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. Kill the fattened calf. Does he treat him like a servant? No, he treats him like a son. And a highly honored, a highly valued, a highly anticipated son who's coming back. And he throws this huge party, invites everybody to come be a part of it. Where's the older son? Out in the field. He's on the outside. And he hears the party, but he's on the outside. And when he hears about the servant, when the servant comes to tell him, what's the older brother's response? Grumbling and complaining. He's angry. Why? Why is he angry? Because he interprets the Father's love. He interprets his grace. He interprets his mercy towards his brother as unjust treatment. Where is justice? He doesn't share the Father's heart at all. Third example of the Father's lavish abundance. What does the Father do? He goes out to his older son. Not something a dignified man would do. You see, a man at that time would say, "Son, time to come in." He says, "No." He says, "You better get your rear end in here." Right? The father has all the power in this. He doesn't have to, but he goes out to the older son. He goes out to him. Remember, Jesus had told the parable of the fig tree. Who is the fig tree? Do y'all remember? I know it's been a few weeks. Israel, right? Right? It's the Pharisees. It's the leadership. It's the folks that should have been, had known, received Jesus when he first came because they've been looking for him forever. And that the owner of the vineyard goes out to the fig tree and he looks at it and what does he find on the fig tree? Nothing. Cut it down. And the vineyard keeper says, "Give me one more year. Let me dig around it. Let me put some fertilizer in there. Let's see if we can get it to bear fruit." And Jesus is telling this parable saying, "I want you to bear fruit." He goes out to the older brother because he has a desire. He loves the older brother too. And he's saying, "Come into the party. We want you to be a part of this." And yet the older brother says what? "No, thank you." Right? When this son of yours, who has wasted all your stuff, you throw big parties for him, but me, I've worked for you forever. I've done everything you've told me to do. And yet you don't throw parties for me. And you can see that the older son, in many ways, is farther away than the younger son was. He doesn't know his father. He doesn't share his father's character. He's very different than the father. And yet the father's still inviting this brother of yours, right? We had to celebrate because he was dead and is now alive. He was lost and has been found. Don't you see? We have to celebrate. How does God view those who are lost? Whether they're unrighteous or self-righteous, he loves them. Right? That the prodigal in this story is the father. He is the prodigal. He's the one who is reckless in his love. He's the one who's wasteful in his grace. He is the one who's lavishly abundant in his pursuit of us. That he sits waiting, watching, hoping, looking for us. Waiting that for us to come to him. To begin that journey, and he runs and he meets us right where we are. Not waiting for us to clean ourselves up, but embraces us. And we become sons and daughters of the King, and there's a huge party. And today you may see yourself as a younger son. And maybe you think that you've lived a lifestyle, and maybe you still are living that lifestyle where you feel like, "Man, I'm so far away from God, there's no way that he would welcome me into his family. If you only knew the things that I've done, if you only knew the things that I'm doing right now, there's no way." But no one is beyond the Father's love. You can't run far enough. You can't hide well enough. You can't escape the Father's love. But you have to recognize yourself first, right? You have to see who you are first. You have to recognize that you're a wayward son or daughter. You have to say, "I have a need for him," or you'll never call out to him. And then you have to believe that Jesus is the one who can meet that need. And then you have to trust him to do that. You have to come home. Maybe you're more like the older brother, and maybe you haven't lived this pagan lifestyle. Maybe your outward show looks really righteous or religious to a lot of folks. Maybe when they look at you, they think, man, that's a good person. But your problem is you have a wrong view of yourself and a wrong view of God. You think that God demands a lot and gives little. You think that righteousness is something that's not given but has to be taken, has to be earned. That when you see the grace of God in somebody else's life, that you become angry. They should be getting what they deserve. Why are they getting God's mercy? It's because you haven't experienced His grace in your own life. That you don't share the heart of the Father for the lost. You don't get excited when there's one rose up here. You don't celebrate because you don't know the Father. Right? Maybe you're the older brother today. And Jesus, when He tells this story to the Pharisees, you know what His hope is? His hope is that they'd share the heart of the Father. His hope is that they would see. He's digging around that tree. He's adding fertilizer. He's inviting the older brother, come be a part of the party. I'm not trying to kick you out. I want you in. And so if that's you, He invites you to come. See yourself for who you are. Someone who's in need of a Savior. And then trust Him to save you. Now this parable works on a couple of different levels. Because you know what? As believers, sometimes we blow our lives up too. We make stupid choices. And we go down bad paths. And you know what God would say to you? Come home. Come home. Right? And it's the same picture of a father who's waiting anxiously. Waiting anxiously to welcome you back in. Not tapping his toe and looking at you and going, you know what, you're going to get grounded for this. This is really going to be bad this time. But He's a Father who welcomes you in and lavishes you with His love. And sometimes, again, we can be the older brother where we trusted in Jesus at some point, but we don't struggle with the same sin issues that other people do. And over time, maybe we've gotten some victory in some areas and we forgot what it's like to be lost, to be in need. And we start to think, I don't really need Jesus as much right now. And can you believe what that person's doing? Right? And how can you hang out with those people? Don't you know they're sinners? And that we've replaced some of the, maybe the pagan stuff that we used to do with things like pride and judgmentalism. And jealousy. And that we begin to look down on other folks and we begin to put them down because they're not like us. And Jesus wants us to come home. He wants us to be like the older brother who gets it. Who's standing there with his dad. Says, there he is. There he is, Dad. Who runs down the path with his dad, and who welcomes his brother home. That's who Jesus wants us to be, right? He wants us to have that same excitement, that same sense of satisfaction, that same sense of joy when only one trusts in Him. I love this description that A.W. Tozier had of God's love. He says it this way. Because God is self-existent, His love had no beginning. Because He's eternal, His love can have no end. Because He is infinite, it has no limit. Because He is holy, it is the quintessence of all spotless purity. Because He is immense, His love is an incomprehensibly vast, bottomless, shoreless sea. Do you want to know how the Father sees you? He sees you with the kind of love that is so big and so vast and so incomprehensible that He wants you to come home. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for your amazing, amazing, amazing love. That like the younger son, that we have all rebelled against you in lots of different ways, that we've all run far from you, we've all made choices, and we've all been in places where we have rejected you, denied you, whether it was verbally or by our actions. And yet, all that while, that your love never grew cold. That you never stopped seeking, you never stopped looking for us, waiting for that moment when we would recognize that life is not working for us. And Father, we thank you that in those moments, even when we're in our minds trying to make deals with you and figure out how we can get the best out of this thing, that still you are there and you cut us short. That the only kind of forgiveness you offer is total forgiveness. That you embrace us and kiss us and welcome us in as sons and daughters. And Father, we thank you for that. And Father, I pray for those who are still far from you, who are still living a lifestyle that making bad life choices. I pray for that moment of clarity. I pray for that realization of their need to turn to you. And I pray for those who think they're close, who think that they're good people, who have it all together. Father, I pray that they would have a sense of their deep need for you. And I pray that we as a church would share your heart for the lost. That we might be like the older brother who stands by the father, who anxiously is also looking for the son, for his brother to come home, who runs to meet him. That, Father, we would go to whatever extremes, the folks that you've placed on our impact list, the people that you have placed in our hearts, that, Lord, that we would do whatever it takes. And once they come to know you, that there would be this sense of celebration and a sense of excitement. And Lord, I pray that we would see many, 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 many more roses here. I pray that the grounds wouldn't be enough, the rose bushes that would be planted. I pray that this valley might be impacted in incredible ways because we got it. We saw the love of the Father and it became the love that we have. Gave us purpose and meaning, gave us a mission, rescued sinners that rescue sinners. We pray these things in Jesus' name, amen.